I'd like to start off today with something we always start with veterans. Jack and Grevy, if you would lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Stand by, everybody, on your feet, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of
the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Amen. Please be seated. As most of you know, Senator Joe Vitale has been a veteran advocate for years and years. And I want you to know, he just completed his 14th year with the bus trips from Woodbridge to New York, New York for Fleet Week. That's two buses with 100 veterans and friends. And buses cost $800 for a driver and a bus. For each bus, $800. That's a lot of money, and we thank Joe. As Richie Duffy, the Marine, said, Joe is not an Election Day patriot. He's been out there year in and year out taking care and appreciate what you veterans have done for our country. And now, I got to tell you about our Assemblyman Craig Coughlin. He is a great team member, and he just completed raising $150,000 for the poor and needy with his campaign voting for those people. And then our mayor also gets thanks for having the best police department in our state. Mayor McCormick just completed his 10th year of hosting the Senior Citizens Affair. And they were telling me that they had 122 participants that took place. And Senator, I want you to know, McCormick has two paisans helping them out.
All right.
Pasquale Trombetta and Frank St. Marie. So we got to catch up to those guys for our needs. So what else we got here? Anyway, we'll get on with our program. Now, my first guest of honor is, where hell is she at? Okay, here we go. Former Tech Sergeant Jennifer Myers. She's a veteran of 20 years active duty, who for the last 7 years is working with the NORC Veterans Administration Regional Office, where she oversees the implementation of new programs and is also the Public Affairs Office as well. She is well educated with an associate degree from the Air Force, a BS degree from Southern Illinois, and a master's degree from Central Michigan University. But most important, she is a native New Yorker, and this means street smarts that comes along with the territory. Anyway, right now I shall call up to the front our guest of honor, Sergeant Jennifer Myers, front and center, please. Where's my helper?
Where's your assistant?
Sharon?
Right here.
You got the proclamation?
I gave it to Jack.
I've got it right here, Jack.
Oh, okay.
Mac, Mayor. Where'd you go?
Good
morning, everyone. Thank you for being here again this year. And I want to thank Jack McGreevy and Sharon and John Eberhardt, Vito from the Community Center for putting this thing together again this year. It's really a great time to be able to say thank you to our veterans, both who are either serving still, who are in active duty, or served our country in a variety of different ways. And we're really proud to be able to say thank you. Happy that you're here. Grateful for the sacrifice that you made for our country and for our freedom. And today we try to find, it's not hard to do, you know, three heroes that served our country, and to give them some recognition that they deserve. Certainly, they didn't serve our country for the recognition. They didn't do it for any other reason other than their love of our country and keeping us free and safe. And so we're really very grateful for that. Our first recipient this morning, as Jack mentioned, is Jennifer Myers. We have a resolution for her. She's a member of the community during the Veterans Outreach Forum here today. We want to honor her for the work she's done. She was a member of the United States Air Force, a 20-year in the Air Force after her retirement in 2009, achieving the rank of Tech Sergeant and earning numerous citations, awards, and decorations for her distinguished efforts. And she's especially appreciated as a woman of concern and character who made a significant contribution to America's attempts to establish peace throughout the world. And for that, we are eternally grateful and so honored that you're here today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator. Good morning, everyone. It's a privilege to be with you here once again this year, to take this opportunity to say thank you for your service, thank you for your commitment, and thank you for being an example to all of us of what it means to be somebody who is committed and does things for something bigger than themselves. It's a message that I hope that, young people continue to hear and see an example. You know, I think we're doing a better job at reaching out to veterans, at recognizing their sacrifice and their service. We still have a ways to go. There are always going to be challenges in terms of that. But I think we need to be proud of the fact that veterans now, you know, I grew up during the Vietnam War and right after that. Those were tough times. I don't think veterans were treated as well as they ought to have been. But now I think we're doing a better job. And it's something that you deserve, and I thank you for that. I thank you for your service, and I thank you for the opportunity to be here again today. I would ask for a round of applause for our friend Jack McGreevy. He is just as special and as committed as you can imagine. You know, nothing happens without a lot of hard work, and Jack puts in that hard work each and every day. I don't know anybody who's ever come to him that didn't see him as a real advocate. And we're fortunate to have him in our Ledge office. And we're fortunate to have him to help represent you. So to all of the honorees this morning, thank you very much. It's a privilege to be able to give you these resolutions. I thank you for coming out. The good news is I'm on the program 3 or 4 times. I'm an Irish guy. I like to talk. I won't be back, I promise. But thanks again for coming out. Have a great day. Thank you again for your service. Let me introduce my friend, Mayor John McCormick. Huh?
Thank you, Craig. Sorry I was a little bit late, but the St. James Street Fair kicked off a little bit late. I want to just thank everybody for coming here. We're a town that very much takes our veterans very, very seriously. We do so much working with Joe and Craig, and I think Joe is the best advocate a veteran could have in the state of New Jersey. He is just as a phenomenal representative down in our state senate. He's been there since 1997. I'm sure Frank and Ray and all the people from the state that make the rounds all over New Jersey, when they come to Woodbridge, they know the commitment that Joe and that Craig have. I also want to thank a young guy who I worked with back in the 90s in the town when I was a CFO. He was the recreation director. Then I left for a couple of years to be in Trenton and came back, and he was still the recreation director. And then he said one day he wanted to retire. And I said, that's fine, Mr. Eberhardt, you can retire all you want, but you're going to still work part-time helping the special needs kids, which he started back in the early 90s, and you're still going to work part-time with the veterans of Woodbridge Township. And he helped us start the Veterans Alliance back in 2007. And I said, you can retire all you want, but you're not going to stop working. And John has just done a fantastic job for the township. So I do want to thank everybody that's here. And you know, the last couple of years at our concerts, we've honored veterans. We did World War II. Then we did Korea, then we did Vietnam. I guess this year coming up, we'll do Iraq and Afghanistan. So if you know anybody, we want to reach out. And, you know, I'll tell you, there's never a better moment in town than that night, the first night we did this with the World War II veterans. There was a dozen guys up there just absolutely beaming when the crowd, as soon as the last one was introduced, the crowd just stood up and started cheering for about 5 minutes. It was just amazing. It was wonderful to see that. This town really does appreciate what you have done for us and what you all continue to do for us. Thank you very much.
Oh, sure.
Okay, it is my job to present a resolution to Gary White.
Come on up.
Okay, let me tell you about the Avenel Detachment of the Marine Corps League. It's now called the Reinhardt Detachment of the Marine Corps League in honor of Kevin J. Reinhardt, who passed away in 2012 in Afghanistan, a Colonia guy from our town. And they gave up their name and honored Kevin with his name permanently now forever on the Reinhardt Detachment of the Marine Corps League. That is just an amazing thing that these men did, so thank you for that. Whereas Gary T. White served his country with honor as a member of the United States Marine Corps and Navy, earning the National Defense Service Ribbon, Battle E Ribbon, Sea Service Deployment Ribbon, and the Unit Meritorious Commendation for his distinguished efforts. And he is especially appreciated as a man of concern and character who made a significant contribution to America's attempts to establish peace throughout the world. And whereas since his discharge from the military, Gary T. White has enjoyed a superb career at the United States Department of Transportation, Federal Railroad Administration, lending his wisdom and expertise as Chief Operating Practices Inspector. And whereas the servicemen and women of the U.S. Armed Forces, epitomized by Gary T. White, have borne great burdens and made great sacrifices in the services of the cause of freedom and democracy, not only for our country, but also for others who would embrace those ideals. And whereas it is altogether proper and fitting for the members of the legislature and the people of the state to recognize the courage, determination, and loyalty demonstrated by Gary T. White in his service to our country now, and it goes on to say the legislature issues him this proclamation. Congratulations, Gary.
Thank you, Senator. It is my privilege to present a resolution to Bill Wisk. Come on up. Now, I was teasing him before when I walked in here, but it's true. In addition to being an amazing citizen and a wonderful person, Bill is also the best damn dancer in Woodbridge Township. You can give him a round of applause because this guy can dance. I've been at a wedding with him, and the women lined up to dance with him. Most of us were standing there going, honey, what are you doing? I can dance now. And they said, no, I'll wait an hour for Bill. But besides that, it's absolutely true, right? It's absolutely true. Let me just tell you a little bit about Bill. Bill has served his country with honor and valor as a member of the 1st Cavalry Division of the United States Army during Vietnam, earning the National Defense Service Medal, the Vietnam Service Medal, the Vietnam Campaign Medal, the Army Commendation Medal, and two overseas service bars for his distinguished efforts. And he is especially appreciated as a man of concern and character who made a significant contribution to America's attempts to establish peace throughout the world. And since his discharge from the military, Bill has been actively involved in the Department of Veterans Affairs, and he's currently lends his wisdom and insight as the post commander of VFW post number 1352 in Hope Lawn. And so Bill, all of us in the legislature recognize your great accomplishments, your great talents, your great service, and it's our privilege to present you with this resolution here today. Thank you very much. Congratulations. Too much stuff.
Thank you.
Just want to, if we can get all three of our honorees up here, Mayor, and take a picture for the record.
Come on over here. You get on that side.
Let's hear for our honorees. My wife is a little bit dance, by the way.
John?
I just want to recognize a good friend of Woodbridge, Middlesex County, of course, and a great, great veterans advocate, someone who takes that title, albeit informal, very seriously. He's a great guy, a good friend to Woodbridge, and a great friend to veterans, especially our field director, Ronnie Rios. Carteret.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator, Mayor McCormick, the Veterans Advisory Council, for doing this every year. It's so important that we work hard to promote our programs, whatever programs we have in Middlesex County. We work diligently to promote and enhance and create new programs for our veterans. I have a certain adoration for veterans because if it wasn't for veterans, we wouldn't be able to just meet here like this today. And I take that seriously, and I instill that in kids when I go speak to kids in school, that the freedoms we have, we just can't take for granted. People lost their lives and shed their blood for us, not knowing who we're gonna be. And that's so important. We instituted 3 years ago in Middlesex County a Veterans Housing Assistance Program, and we put $100,000 in our budget every year to create a new program for veterans, whether they're for a security deposit, for rental arrears, and helping them out, whether they were from World War II or the latest conflict that we're at. So it's so important. And that program was recognized nationally as the first. And we're proud of that. And it's so important that we keep these things going on and on and on. I grew up during the Vietnam era, and it was shameful for what our veterans had to endure that were coming back from Vietnam. Shameful how people treated them. So I have a lot of respect, and I can't emphasize enough how important it is that we continue the legacy of what veterans mean and what things we can continue to do to bring for you guys. And I can't thank you enough for what you do, even when you get out of the service. And I mean, I see guys that are from World War II, and they're actively involved in the VFW, American Legion, or Catholic War Vets, or Jewish War Vets, and it's so important, or the Marine Corps League. And I want to thank Jack McGreevy for what he does. That's okay, we could say that, thank you. But in any event, thank you, thank you, thank you, because it's a special person. That's an American veteran, and I can't thank you enough for what you do for me. God bless you.
Thank you for your help. Also, another special guest here today that came all the way from the shores of Old Bridge, our county clerk, Elaine Flynn. Come on up. It's here for Elaine Flynn, our county clerk. She has an Irish last name, but she's always telling us she's Polish and proud.
Thanks, Joe. It's one of the things that the county tries to do for the veterans is something that my passport office has initiated. I'd like to thank Linda DeShuda, who's from my office, for coming every veterans exhibit and telling you all about it. It is, how do I obtain a Middlesex County Veteran Service Card? If you have registered your DD-214 with us, we then give you a card that indicates that you are a veteran in good standing. With it, you get this booklet that tells you how many places that you can go get 5, 10, 15, 20% off on the services that you require. So please take advantage of it. It's right behind that pillar over there, and you can find out the directions for what you do. I also want to thank you for your service. I have grown up through a couple of wars, and luckily I did lose my godfather as a Marine, and it was an incredibly sad situation. Our soldiers overseas, men and women, get the highest regard from us, from our freeholder director, who has a special place in his heart for veterans, and I want to thank you very much for your service. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Just so you know, folks, right here in the room, we have a great representation for our veterans, from our mayor to our county, to Freeholder Director Ron Rios, to our Assembly, Craig Coughlin, to our State Senate with Joe Vitale, so we have great representation for our veterans. We can go to these guys anytime you want. Any questions, they'll deal with it. Speaking of questions, we have a whole bunch of people here that are going to answer your questions. So when we get done with the presentations, please feel free to walk around, talk to everybody. Another person I just want to quickly thank is a person I have lunch with every week. And if you're a fly on the wall, you'd enjoy yourselves because it's Navy versus Marine and the conversations get pretty heavy. But Jack and I, we meet at least once a week for lunch and we try to plan what we need for our veterans here locally. So thank you, Jack, for everything. I'd like to start with, we're going to change the order a little bit. Mr. Brand Spiegel has an event to get to. If yet you cannot meet a nicer person who takes care of our veterans at the Menlo Park Veterans Memorial Home. And with that, Joe, would you?
Good
morning. Thank you. John, thank you for inviting me once again. I'm very happy to be here. Again, my name is Joseph Brandspiegel, and I am the CEO of a wonderful, wonderful facility in Edison, New Jersey, the New Jersey Veterans Memorial Home. Let me just give you a quick synopsis as to, you know, what this is all about, just in case you didn't know. And I hope that's not the case. We are a 312-bedded facility. We call ourselves a long-term care facility, not a nursing home. We are a very unique facility. You name it, we have it. We have a chapel, we have a full-time chaplain, we have a gift shop, we have a library, we have a barber shop, we have a deli, and the list goes on and on and on. We are a full-service facility. We are a very unique facility. We do employ full-time physicians. We have a dentist in our employ. We have a fully equipped dental office so that when you are a resident there, we don't have to inconvenience you to send you to a dental office to have your tooth repaired or have a denture. We do it ourselves. We have full-time physicians, as I mentioned, 24/7. We are very, very unique. We have 125 acres of land. It's a very, very beautiful area, just in case you wish to come to see us one of these days. We have dietitians. We want to make sure that we give you the proper diet. We watch your diet, make sure you don't get too much salt. Activity therapy is great. We have 4 buses. We have full-time drivers. We go to Atlantic City. We go down the beach. We go all over the place. What we want to do is make sure that our residents don't stay in bed 24/7 and do absolutely nothing. Because if you do that, the only thing you develop is a bed sore. And as some of you know, it takes 3 hours to develop a bed sore, and it takes forever to get rid of one. We don't want that. If any time you wish to come to see us, there is always something going on in our facility. We are very, very fortunate that we have friends like you who come to visit us. We have many, many veteran organizations, the Jewish War Veterans, the Korean War Veterans, the American Legion, and the list goes on and on and on, who actually come to stay with our residents, barbecues on weekends, and also supporting us financially. If I need a bus, which I do, 2 years ago, the American Legion purchased us a brand new bus. It cost only $72,000, which you could not afford. As you all know, the state of New Jersey has some financial difficulties, so I could not afford to buy a new bus. So what do? I come to you, and you always come through. And that is very, very much appreciated. Financially speaking, you as a veteran, just in case you need us, the only criteria is you need to be a veteran. Okay? If you are not a veteran, we are not for you. Of course, your wife is also going to be considered. You have to have medical needs, obviously. Financially speaking, I never ask how much money do we have. That is never a criteria when you come to stay with us. In a private nursing homes, as you all know, in the state of New Jersey, it would cost you approximately $100,000 a year. That's how much it costs. In our facility, it depends. Depends how much money you have. It's a sliding scale type of arrangement. The more money you have, the more we charge. The less money you have, the less we charge. If you don't have any money, we don't charge, okay? That is never a consideration. So I can assure you, once you get in, some facilities might ask you to leave when your money is no longer there. That is not the case with us. Our only purpose, just I want to mention to you, is you as a veteran, you serve your country, and you deserve a facility such as ours. And the state of New Jersey actually takes care of you as a veteran, and I personally very, very appreciative of that. You deserve to be there. Our only purpose is to provide you with respect and dignity for the rest of your life. And I think we do that well. We are extremely well staffed. Please come to see us anytime. We are open 7 days a week, obviously. If you wish to come to, we'll be happy to give you a tour, including weekends. I have applications on my desk if you wish to pick one up. Hopefully you don't need one, but just in case, one never know. The only thing I'm asking you is, we do have a 5-month waiting list. There are many residents or family members who call me desperately and say, hey, can you help me out? My father's been discharged from JFK and he has no place to go. Sorry, I can't do much. All veterans are equal. They are all standing in line. First come, first serve, okay? But if you need us, fill out an application, bring it in, let us have it. We'll be happy to talk to you. And when the time comes, hopefully, we'll be happy to help you. I want you to know that we are under the Department of Veterans and Military Affairs. Okay, just in case you did not know. Ray Zawacki, who is here this morning as the Deputy Commissioner, is basically we report to him, who reports to a general, basically, who reports to the governor. That's what we do. So we are under the Department of Veterans and Military Affairs. Anytime you come to us, you might see generals or colonels or National Guardsmen come to us to visit. That's obviously very much appreciated. If I can be of any help to you, I want you to know I'm available 24/7. We take our jobs very, very seriously. We are fully staffed, as I mentioned before. I have business cards, just in case you need me. Please call me, do not hesitate. I hope you don't need us, but if you do, we are there to assist. Again, thank you very much for your time. Appreciate it.
One of the key words that Joe had mentioned was personally, and I can attest to the fact that personally, Joe makes sure that that home gets his personal attention. So thank you very much. Had a perfect lead-in for a good friend of mine. Before I do that, one person we didn't mention was, I had mentioned at lunchtime, we have a Marine Navy. On occasion, they double-team me and Doug Breen shows up. So it's two Marines against one sailor. I keep telling them fair fight. To even the score up, however, another Navy veteran and a great advocate for your veterans, Raymond Zawacki.
Thank you. Good morning. Distinguished guests, comrade veterans, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here this morning, and as I do every year, I come to this forum, and it's a great forum. And I've got to tell you that Joe Brandspiegel, who you just heard last, did a great job for a guy who had major surgery last week. And he came back to work this week, and he's doing a great job at the home. So thanks, Joe, and thanks for being here. I thought I was going to have to do it on my own, but there we energy right there, too, Dave. You heard Joe talk about Menlo Park, and that's great. We have two other homes that are just as equal as Menlo Park in terms of caring for those who are eligible to receive that care. And I have to tell you that veterans and their spouses and Gold Star parents as well can come to the home and realize that kind of care, receive that kind of care that they receive. In many cases, their health is so improved that they live longer lives, statistically, and data proves it, than they would if they had to use community facilities. And that, I believe, I fully believe in large part, that is true because of all of you, especially the organizations, Marine Corps, Lee, and I didn't put that first just because Jack McGreevy is here. The American Legion, the VFW, the Catholic War Veterans, the DAV, all of them, even the ELS, which is not traditionally known as a veterans organization, contribute and support those homes to such an extent that it has a very positive effect on the residents. And we certainly appreciate everything that you do in that regard. Some of the benefits that are available from the state in addition to the homes, we have the Brigadier General William C. Doyle Cemetery down in Arneytown, which is available to veterans, honorably discharged veterans. The services that are provided at that cemetery are free of charge. There is no charge to the veteran or his eligible family members. That's usually the spouse and any minor children or children who become disabled before their 18th birthday. So that's available to veterans from a grateful state. We have two homeless veteran transitional housing programs, Veterans Haven, what we call Veterans Haven North and Veterans Haven South. The southern facility is located in Winslow Township, right on the grounds of the Ancora, or outside the grounds of the Ancora State Psychiatric Hospital. And the northern facility is located in Glen Gardner, which is right on the grounds of the former psychiatric facility, the Hagedorn psychiatric facility. That has been closed, and Veterans Haven North has taken over some of that operation. And they're both doing very well. We have 148 residents. I say doing very well in terms of we're okay, we're meeting a need, but it's not really what I would call doing well. I mean, there are 148 folks who are homeless and need our services, and that's far too many, men and women veterans. So it's far too many, so it's really something that we look at doing, you know, as the way we're supposed to, but I wouldn't call it well. I mean, we're accomplishing our goals and we're succeeding. The recidivism rate on veterans that we transfer out to the community after their 2-year stay, and that's averaging around 270 days now, so that's less than a year they're with us, which is a good thing. But the recidivism rate is very low, meaning that when they are fully able to get out to the community, they're ready to go with a place to stay, a good solid home or apartment, a job, and they're clean, free of drugs, free of dependencies, so they're back to the community and back to being productive members of that community, which is the goal, which is our goal. There is also a tax deduction and exemption. There's a $250 tax deduction for veterans who meet the criteria for that. There's an exemption for those who are 100% for a service-connected disability, permanent and total. Veterans preference in civil service. You can receive veterans preference. If you're a disabled veteran, you get an absolute preference. So if you meet the criteria for that, it puts you on a list for state employment, on a list that you're applying for a job for, of state employment that will guarantee that you are selected before anyone else if you're disabled, and in the top three if you're not disabled but a veteran. So that's something the state does, and it's a very powerful benefit. We offer PTSD counseling for those that are recently returned, those that are not recently returned. We have veterans that we see who served during Vietnam, and they need to contact a veteran service officer, the veteran does, and set up this service if they need it. And generally they attempt, our service officers attempt to get the veteran into care, federal care in the VA system to which you're entitled. And if they can't do that, they get them into one of our clinical folks. We have, I think, 14 in the network right now. And we pay them on a scale depending on the term that the veteran is assigned to them for. So that we'll figure all of that out, but that's available to them, and it's a very valuable benefit because it will not only will we counsel the veteran, but his family as well. In those cases where the family is involved or there's a situation involving the family, we will provide that counseling service to them as well. We have a vet-to-vet helpline located at the University of Behavioral Health up in Rutgers University in Piscataway, which has fielded numerous calls over the last 10 years. It continues to handle those calls coming in, providing advice, guidance, and service to veterans that need it. Forums such as this, same thing. I mean, they provide the information and guidance to veterans that may be curious as to a benefit or receipt of a benefit, and how do I go about applying for it, who do I see. Forums like this make that possible, and we are very pleased to be a part of this. As I mentioned before, our veteran service officers are out there in the field. We have all of our counties covered, so feel free to use them, look them up, and get a hold of their number and give them a call. They're an excellent resource for compensation or pension claims, employment, VA health care, a whole list of benefits that you feel, county benefits. They may not be able to provide that benefit, but they may be able to tell you if you're interested in a county benefit, and you tell them what county you're from, they will be able to hook you up with the appropriate individual to get the information, specifically the information that you require at that moment in time. So feel free to use them. In fact, you can feel free to use our department anytime. You can call, and I hate to do this to you, Joe, but you can call Joe Brandspiegel's operation, even for general questions, because he knows where to go and who to see or who to call to get the information that you require. You can call my office, you can call any service officer. We have Joe Batito, located in the Somerset Armory, who covers Middlesex and Somerset counties. So feel free to call him at any time. But we're here to help you, and we're here to help all veterans, all 413,000 of them, 33,000 of which are women veterans. So feel free, we're happy to help. Just give us a call, and like the VA or any of the other organizations or agencies here, we are willing to assist you as well, and so are they. So thanks for the invitation to be here, and thanks again for your service. Really appreciate it.
Folks, a special thank you to Frank. He kind of shifted the list here, but New Jersey Veterans Administration, as we promised, if you have questions, here's the place, guys and gals, to have your questions answered. Just a quick commercial break. Woodbridge High School has a junior ROTC program. It's going well. We got our youngsters, and again, it's not a military obligation, but they get introduced to the military life. We are just starting in Colonia High School, and commanders of VFW, American Legion Post, Marine Corps League, we can use your help with this. We are starting a Sea Cadet Corps in Colonia High School. A special thank you to Ken Priest for that. And with that, our New Jersey Veterans Administration, Mr. Frank Quadrino.
You know, Jack, I'm not Irish, I'm Italian, so you know that, right?
What about favorite fingers?
Okay. It's too much. But anyway, thank you so much for having me here this morning. It's great to be back. I think this is about the seventh or eighth year I've been here, and I really look forward to being here every time. I wish there were more veterans here. I really do, because the information you get from the state, from Joe, look at all the wonderful vendors that came out to provide information to veterans. And I hope for the people who are here today, and you go back, and if you're a member of the American Legion, VFW, Marine Corps League, VBA, whatever, go back and tell your friends, you know what, you missed a good outreach event. And when they have it again next year, tell them to come. Tell them to bring their family members. If the veteran can't come, have a family member come out. They too can get the same information a veteran can get for them. So again, I thank the committee for doing this. I think it's great, and as I said, I look forward to doing this every year. And before I go into VA healthcare, I certainly would be remiss if I didn't take the opportunity, as everybody else has done, to thank everybody in this room who served the country. And in my opinion, whether you served overseas, I know a lot of people say to me, oh, I'm not a veteran because I wasn't overseas. Well, that's baloney, but you know what, whether you served overseas, stateside, guard, reserve, to me, you did something that most of us did not do, and I certainly want to thank you for that, first and foremost, okay? I'm here, I'm going to talk to you about VA healthcare, okay? So with that, how many of you are registered in the VA healthcare system? Raise your hand. A good number of you are. Great, I'm happy to see that. I'm happy to see that you're taking advantage of the benefit that you earned. Because one of the things you're going to find out this morning, and it's unfortunate, not everybody who served their country, believe it or not, is eligible for VA healthcare benefits. That changed in 2003, changed dramatically. It actually changed in 1980, when they said, you know what, you have to serve 2 years instead of just one day. And then they changed it again in 2003 when they said, you know what, some of you, your eligibility is going to be based on your income and your assets. Thank God about 2 years ago they did away with the assets, now it's just income. So they have made it a little bit better. But there are some groups of veterans that are automatically eligible for VA healthcare. XPOWs, any XPOWs out there? Any Purple Heart recipients out there? Paul, you're enrolled, right? Okay, Purple Heart is automatically eligible, okay? Any disabled veterans, service connected, you're automatic, so I hope you folks are enrolled in VA healthcare system, okay? How many of you serve in-country Vietnam, boots on the ground? You're automatic. Here's another one, people don't realize this. How many people served over at Camp Lejeune from 53 to 87, 30 days or more? You're automatic now too. You should go up to the VA, fill out the application because of the dirty water, and hopefully you're getting some sort of information about that being mailed to you. Am I right, sir? You are? Good. Okay. OEF, OIF veterans, when they got home, they were told, you know what, get in the system. You have 5 years to get in, no questions asked. Okay? So those are the groups of veterans that are automatic. What happens to the others? Unfortunately, there's an income threshold, and it changes from state to state and county to county. And it changes every year. It's probably going to change again in another 3 months, come January the 1st. Just to give you an example, this is Middlesex County. For a single veteran, it's approximately, I think, $53,000. For a married veteran, it's $60,000. However, don't let that stop you from filling out the application for two reasons. Number one, the VA also wants to know how much out-of-pocket medical expenses you have, because they will deduct that from your income. And if you're married, they want to know how much out-of-pocket medical expenses your spouse had, because they will deduct that from your income. And sometimes that will put you underneath the threshold. The other thing is, I even tell veterans, you know what, even if you're way over the threshold, fill out the application, mail it into the VA or go up to the VA, because then you'll be in our system. And if the eligibility criteria changes, we now have a name and a number to call you and say, hey, you know what? You applied for VA healthcare benefits and your income was way over, but we just did away with the income threshold. And I will say this, we're gonna have a new president, folks, in another 3 more months. And sometimes that's when things change a lot in the federal government. And there could be one of the candidates who says, you know what, let's open up the VA for all veterans. They all did the same thing. You know, every veteran, you know, and I feel bad when I have to tell a veteran they're not eligible for VA healthcare benefits because of their income. And they'll always say to me, and they look at me and say, you know what, federal government didn't ask me what my income is when I, you know, when I went into the service. Now you're asking me what my income is now to get my benefits. So I do, I feel for you. But fill out the application, okay? Speaking of the application, the VA encourages you to fill it out either online. There's even now a way you can fill that out over the telephone. However, in my opinion, the people who get the best satisfaction when you fill out the application are the ones who do it in person, okay? So you take the application, you fill it out, and I said this to an individual here this morning, I forget where he is, I asked him if you're retired, he said yes. I said, it takes you 30, 35 minutes to drive up to Lyons VA. No appointment necessary, go to Building 3, eligibility, sit down with one of the eligibility people, Amanda or Connie, and the good thing is, if you made a mistake on that application and you're there in person, they'll correct it for you. If you make a mistake on that application, you mail it in, we just say, you know what? We don't know if you made a mistake. You put a wrong number somewhere, denied. So go in person, they'll help you fill out the application, they'll ask you certain questions, okay? Make sure you have your DD-214 with you. Also, make sure you have two other forms of identification, driver's license, you know, something like that, okay? If you're retired military, have your military retiree card with you, and go in person, because I find that is the best way to do it. Plus, in my opinion, you could kill two birds with one stone. A lot of veterans will say to me, Frank, I registered online, I got notice that I'm in the system, but I didn't get my VA ID card. And I'll say, well, did you have your picture taken? Well, no, I registered online. Well, that's why, you know what? If you would have went in person, they would have taken your picture, and 14 days later, you'd get your VA ID card. So in my opinion, which is my opinion only, I would suggest you go in person and fill out the application. And we have the applications back on the table, okay? What are the advantages of enrolling in the VA healthcare system? Well, first of all, the VA, as you all know, we are the largest healthcare industry in this country. We are, throughout the United States, I believe there's 154 VAs, we have approximately 2,000 clinics throughout the state, throughout the country. 2,000 clinics throughout the state, no way. But I'm happy to say, speaking of clinics throughout the state, we're about to actually open up a new one up in Sussex County. Now, I know you're probably sitting here saying, well, what good is that going to do me? I'm in Middlesex County. We have one in Piscataway. How many of you use the Piscataway Clinic? Only three of you? Four of you. It's you other folks here. If you're in Piscataway, if you live near the Piscataway Clinic, you know, you don't have to go up to Lyons or East Orange to get all of your health care. You can see a primary care provider at the Piscataway Clinic. Save yourself about 20 minutes, well, 40 minutes, 20 minutes going up, 20 minutes coming back. Save yourself some gas. So think about that. That's why we put the clinics out there. We're trying to make it easier for you so you're not doing all the traveling. So we are putting one up in Sussex County. Hopefully by the end of the month, that will be completed. Okay? Couple other things. Okay, so now that you get in, you have yourself a primary care provider. The VA offers every other service that you can get in the private sector. Podiatry, cardiology, optometry, audiology, physical therapy, occupational therapy, rheumatology, so on and so forth, okay? As a matter of fact, for those of you who are enrolled in the VA, hopefully you have gotten your free eyeglasses. Have you? I see, okay, you're shaking your head. Okay, so I wanna make sure you know this though too. Because a lot of veterans get confused and they get kind of upset with me. I tell them that they can get free eyeglasses. So they go and they see our audiologist, our optometrist. They get their eyes refracted. They get the glasses, they're happy with the glasses, and they get a bill for $50. And they say, well, you told me the eyeglasses are free. The eyeglasses are free, but not the visit with the optometrist. If you are on a copay status, you're going to have to pay the copay to see a VA optometrist, and that's $50. Just like if you want to have your hearing checked. How many of you have gotten free hearing aids from the VA? Great. The hearing aids are free. But if you're on a copay status, you're going to get a bill for $50. If you're not in a copay status, then guess what? Everything is no charge. So I just want to make sure you understand that. And I have a little bit of better news even now when it comes to eyeglasses and hearing aids. It used to be, I used to stand up here and tell you, make sure you see your primary care doctor if you want to have your eyes checked and your hearing checked, because the primary care doctor was the one who will do the referral. Well, starting the end of October, in VA New Jersey healthcare system, now you don't even have to go through your primary care doctor anymore. So you could, right, it's great. It is wonderful. You just pull up the optometry department or the audiology department and they'll make an appointment. What does that do? Two things. Number one, get you into that clinic a lot sooner because you had to probably wait 4 to 6 weeks for that referral. And number two, it's freeing up our primary care providers now to see people who are coming in with, anybody who has, some sort of an allergy, a cough, or something of that nature that needs their attention. So starting the end of October, if you need an appointment with an optometrist or an audiologist, call that department directly, okay? Few other things that I just want to make sure that you understand that the VA has that's it, your benefit. A lot of people do ask about dental. Free dental is very, very difficult to get at the VA. Is anybody here, if you're a the only way you can get dental care free up at the VA is you have to be 100% service connected for your mouth or your jaw. Voc rehab, I think if you're in voc rehab, right, you can get free dental. If you're an inpatient at the VA, you can get dental. But that's about it. And as you well know, as you get older, dental coverage is very important. It gets very expensive. And about 3 years ago, MetLife and Delta Dental stepped up to the plate and said, you know what, we want to help veterans who are enrolled in the VA healthcare system. And they will offer you a reduced rate dental plan because you're a veteran and that you're using the VA. And the beauty of it, here's the beauty of it. You go up to the VA dentist. So if you live in Woodbridge and you're enrolled in VA healthcare system and you want to enroll in MetLife, they'll send you a list of participating dentists in Woodbridge. And maybe one of them is only 2 or 3 blocks away from where you live. So again, it's saving you the aggravation of driving all the way up to the VA. So again, think about it. I'm telling you right now, the one thing that gets very, very expensive as you get older is dental coverage. So think about getting it then. By the way, everything I'm talking about is in this brochure, and we have them back on the table, okay? How many of you know you can get, I see a few folks here with a cane. Do you go to the VA, sir? Did you get that from the VA? Perfect. Do you know I saw a guy the other day, I think we're in Rahway. Yeah, we were in Rahway, right? Yeah. Were we there Tuesday or Wednesday or something like that?
Yeah.
Okay. He was enrolled in the VA, check. And I said, where'd you get those glasses? He said, oh, I bought them on the outside. I said, how much you pay? He said, $400. I said, you could have gotten them for free. He had a cane. I said, where'd you get the cane? He said, well, I bought it at CVS for, $42. I said, you could have gotten that for free also if you would have went through your doctor at the VA. And no idea that they can get some of these benefits. So things like canes, walkers, wheelchairs, you can get those things for no charge at the VA as long as you're seeing your VA doctor. I know the VA, they encourage you to come up once a year. I'll even say once every 2 years. Things like CPAP machines. Anybody here have sleep apnea? Anybody? Good. I'm glad nobody does. Because that machine is about $500 on the outside. You have sleep apnea, you come to the VA, the VA will give you that machine at no charge. No charge. So these are some of the benefits that you folks earned, and if you're enrolled in the VA healthcare system, take advantage of it. Joe and Ray talked about the the facilities that the state has in Menlo Park and up in Bergen County and Paramus and down in Vineland, they're fantastic. I've been to, I've never been to the one in South Jersey because, you know, I don't go past Ocean County, right? But I have been to Menlo Park and I've been to the one in Paramus. They're beautiful. They're great. I don't know if you know or not, the VA, we have a nursing home up at Lyons VA. And I just want to make sure you understand this because a lot of people will call us up and say, my dad, you know, he fought in World War II and he's ready to get into your nursing home, okay? And the first thing I say, and it's usually a family member, a son or a daughter, I say, is your dad, is he service connected? And the son or the daughter will say, yeah, he's connected. He was connected with the Army, the Marine. I said, no, that's not what I mean. Did he have an injury while he was in the service and did he get rated 10%, 20, 30? Oh, no. Thank God he was fine. And I say, you know, I'm sorry, but he's not going to get into our nursing home. Up at Lyons. If you're not at least 70% service connected, you're not getting in. So that's why that is a great place to look if you're a veteran to get into a nursing home. And the other thing is, and I only found this out about 4 or 5 years ago, the spouse of the veteran, even though the spouse is not a veteran, can get into your facility, correct? Up at Lyons, only the veteran. The spouse can't get in. They didn't serve their country. So, you know, again, I just want to make sure you understand that because I don't want you sitting there thinking, oh, great, you know what, they have a 240-bed nursing home up at Lyons. When my day comes, I'll just pick up the phone and I'll get in. And even with that, you know, that criteria, we have a waiting list too. There's a lot of 70% or 80%, 90%, 100% that want to get into our nursing home up at Lyons. Okay? So, with that being said, I just want to let you know one more thing before I finish up. On the back table, you will see a flyer that looks like this. The VA New Jersey healthcare system is actually, the administrators are having an open forum for anybody who wants to go up to East Orange VA on Monday, September 26th from 1 to 3 p.m. It's on the third floor auditorium. And you will get an opportunity to meet with the administrators of the VA and hear what they have to say. You know, just to let you know, we've had a little change up at the VA. Our director and our associate director both retired on July 1st, and then I think it was August 1st, our chief of staff went to Washington. So we have a big change of management up there. So this is an opportunity if you want to go ask questions and hear, see what they have to say. This is an opportunity for you to go up there. Okay, so with that being said, I don't want to take up any more of your time, and I know there, again, please take advantage and walk around and see all the great, wonderful vendors that are here that offer information to veterans. Besides myself and the VA, I have David Brimmer. There's David. Okay, yes, give him a hand, yes. David's an OEF, OEF veteran, and so with the VHA now, I would say for about 5 months. Okay, he came from the Vet Center. He's working OEF, OIF, and he's also doing a lot of outreach with me. And we have Jennifer Degner. Where's Jennifer? Is she here? There's Jen. She's a homeless outreach coordinator. You know, that's another thing. A lot of people, you know, don't realize all the different services we have. We have a homeless outreach coordinator. We have a women's program manager. So for female veterans, when they come up to the VA, we make sure they get in contact with Janine Decker. We have an OEF, OEF program manager. So if you serve in Iraq or Afghanistan, you get assigned to a specific program. You get yourself a case manager if you need it. You know, we have a justice outreach person who goes out to the jails in the state of New Jersey and meets with the veterans who unfortunately had a little bit of bad luck. Okay, and became incarcerated. So we have all of these wonderful services up at the VA. And it's also, wait a minute, I forgot one other thing. Where's Teresa? There she is. Cherie, yeah, give her a hand. How many people heard of vet centers? Look at this. Oh, good. All right. Vet centers do great things for combat veterans. Free counseling for not only you and your family members. And when they mean family members, they really stretch the word family.
I've known some people who not even related to the veteran. They're just best friends. They're really not family. And the Vet Center will allow them to come in and be counseled too. Am I correct, Teresa? Okay. So they offer wonderful, wonderful programs. Go see Teresa if you have a chance and see what she has to say. So again, I thank you for you know, Doug and the group and having this event. I hope you continue this because I think it's a wonderful thing. And I think, where was it? Knowledge is power. I was looking at that when I was sitting there. And the more knowledge, the more information you have, the better off you're going to be. I'll tell you that right now. So again, thank you so much for your service, and have a good weekend. Thank you.
He's too much.
You did a great job.
We're fulfilling our promise of getting the information out to you guys. Thank you, Frank. Thank you, Joe. Thank you, Ray. One person who, with Jack and I, sit down, we work the program out, try to get everything ready for you here, Mr. Doug Green. Now we're back to two Marines, one Navy again.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everybody. I'll make this nice and quick. I just want to say thank you for coming. We do this every year in conjunction with Woodbridge. Very happy to have been invited. Jack, John, Ron, worked with you in the past. Also just like to recognize some of the volunteers that work with me in the Middlesex County Veterans Advisory Council. Paul, stand up if you would. Dave Rimmer. Bob, are you around? Bob Porter, where are you? I'm out in the bedroom, Bob. Henry, my assistant over here, worked with me. And then my longtime boss, Bridget. So we say thank you for all that you helped us with. As the Freeholder touched on, we have the Veterans Housing Assistance Program. We're the only county that does this in the state, which is still amazing to me that we are the only one doing this. But we're at a very special county here. We have that program to help veterans that are either facing eviction, they're behind on their rent, they're looking to find a new place, they need help with a down payment. This is in recognition of their service to our country. We've been very busy. Henry's coming back soon. We need you. Come back soon, please. We have a stack of people we're working on, and again, we want to say thank you. So please take the time, if you will, when we get finished here, to walk around and just visit some of the agencies that are here that have some good information on benefits. And again, thank you for coming. Be safe.
Two last thank yous. Thank you to TV35. I say this all the time. he can't turn the camera on himself. Thank you, Joe. TV35 is a local TV station, and whatever is happening in Woodbridge, turn on the TV35 and you'll find it, whether it's a parade, whether it's a sporting event, whether it's there's movies even at night, there's shows, so great wealth of information. The last thank you is to everybody here. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your service. Don't forget to stop by the tables. Thank you.